Hello, welcome to chapter number 5. In this chapter, you will learn the basics about production and production costs within the company from an economics perspective. Let's start with production and then we'll move to cost. Okay, at the center of the analysis is the production function, which basically is a mathematical expression that denotes the amount of output Q that can be produced given a set of inputs. Inputs are the factors of production, and normally in economics we use K for capital and L for labor. So the simplest production function is shown here. Output Q is a function of two inputs, K, which is the number of units of capital, and L, which is the number of units of labor. Now, another building block in this analysis is the very important distinction between the short run and the long run. In economics, there is not a clear period of time to define this, like a month, a semester, or 2 years. No, since the short and long runs depend on the company and the industry. Different companies and different industries have different periods. Instead, economists define the short run as the period of time where some inputs are fixed. That means these inputs cannot be changed or adjusted. Normally, it is assumed that capital is a fixed input in the short term, but labor is not, because you can adjust the number of workers. The long run, on the other hand, is a period of time over which all inputs can change. All inputs are variable. That is, in the long run, both capital and labor can be adjusted by a manager. Now, given a production function, it is useful to compute three measures of productivity. First, total product, which is Q. Second, average product, which is a measure of the output produced per unit of input. So you can calculate average product of labor, APL, and average product of capital, APK. Third, marginal product, which is the change in total output when a given input changes by one unit. Thus, you can calculate marginal product of labor, MPL, and marginal product of capital, MPK. You can see a numerical example in the for further study section. Now, you can consult your textbook to see how these measures of productivity are calculated for the short run in a table format. This slide shows how the measures of productivity look in relation to each other as they reveal important information. First, notice that the total product TP increases as more units of labor are added. That makes sense. It reaches a maximum point. Notice that this happens when marginal product is equal to zero, and then starts declining when marginal product becomes negative. The second thing that you need to notice is that marginal product MP intersects average product AP at its maximum. We will come to this point when we discuss production costs, so don't forget this important relationship. Okay, now, how do we apply these concepts? Well, one important role of any manager is to use the right combination of inputs to maximize profits. In the short run, this essentially boils down to a simple but powerful principle. To maximize profits, the manager will hire, number one, labor until the value of the marginal product of labor equals the wage rate. And number two, capital until the value of the marginal product of capital equals the rental rate. Notice that the value of the marginal product of labor is calculated by multiplying the marginal product of labor times price, and that the value of the marginal product of capital is calculated by multiplying the marginal product of capital times price. The price, of course, is the price that you charge for the product. The reason we are looking in production we're looking at production and productivity is because in the end, managers want to minimize cost and they need this information to do so. In fact, a very important rule in order to minimize cost is to produce at a given level of output where the marginal product per dollar spent is equal for all inputs. Or equivalently, a firm should employ inputs such that the marginal rate of technical substitution equals the ratio of input prices. You can consult your textbook and also the for further study clips for examples and more information. Now, the same way we have a production function, we can build a total cost function, TC, which is composed by fixed cost, FC, and variable cost, VC. Notice that this function depends on the level of product Q. Also notice that, as discussed earlier, in the long run, there are no fixed inputs, and thus, there are no fixed cost. In other words, in the long run, once again, all costs are variable. This graph shows how costs operate in the short run. Fixed costs are constant and those shown as a horizontal line. This means that they are independent of the level of output. Variable costs start at zero but increase with output. And total costs are obtained by adding fixed cost and variable cost. Similar to what we did with production, we can calculate four very important cost measures. Average fixed cost, which is equal to fixed cost divided by output. Average variable cost, which is equal to variable cost divided by output. Average total cost, which is equal to total cost divided by output. And finally, marginal cost, which are equal to the change in total cost divided by the change in output. Once again, you can consult your textbook to see how these measures of cost are calculated for the short run in a table format. For now, this graph shows how these cost measures look in relation to each other as they reveal important information. First, notice that the marginal cost curve intersects the average cost curve at its minimum. And second, notice the U-shaped form of MC, ATC, and AVC. They decline with output, reach a minimum, and they all start rising. Costs in the long run are different. Since all inputs are variable, there are no fixed costs. This means that the manager is free to adjust the levels of all inputs. In consequence, we use the so-called long-run average cost curve, which defines the minimum average cost of producing different levels of output, while allowing for optimal selection of both fixed and variable factors of production. A graph is easier to understand, so here it is. This graph shows three sets of cost structures, which correspond to three different company sizes, and also shows the long-run cost structure denoted by LRAC, the long-run average cost curve. Notice that while any output level can be produced by any of the three company sizes, the optimal output level, that is the output level that minimizes cost in the long run, is achieved by company size 2 at Q star. In other words, although this output level can be produced under company size 1 or company size 3, only company size 2 ensures minimum production cost. This basic idea implies a very important concept called economies of scale. Economies of scale take place when long-run average costs decline as output increases. However, if the long-run average cost increases as output increases, it is called diseconomies of scale. When the long-run average cost remains constant as output increases, we call this constant returns to scale. These ideas are better captured here on this chart. The idea of cost minimization in the long run is to select a company size that produces at Q star in the long run average cost curve. A few industries enjoy constant return to scale over a large range of output. This situation gives such industries the advantage of being able to increase or reduce production while being able to keep production cost at a minimum in the long run. Finally, another important concept is what we call economies of scope, which exist in the total cost of production of two goods, Q1 and Q2 together. This happens when producing these two goods together is less than the total cost of producing each good individually. Again, check your textbook for examples as well as the For Further Study clips. Okay, this concludes the lecture for chapter 5. So until next chapter.